From the reasons why we are going to Mars in the first place to living underground. Join us as we find out what SpaceX will do once they get to Mars. Eggs, basket, bad. Without becoming overly dramatic about space advocacy, you do need to know why Earth is a bad place for all of humanity to live. There is no human being any further than 450 kilometers from Earth, which is the neighborhood of the International Space Station's orbit. Even the dozen men that walked on the moon were never farther than 400,000 kilometers from our planet. Earth exists in the middle of a cosmic shooting gallery. There are billions and billions of objects in our solar system, and they are either very stable, like the planets, or jostling around like asteroids, waiting for the opportunity to begin the long, slow fall towards the sun. As the mighty planet Jupiter swings around our solar system, its mass tugs at all the rocky remnants in the asteroid belt, altering their courses. Most of them just take up new orbits in the asteroid belt. Some of them get shoved off into the interstellar depths, never to be seen again. While others are redirected inwards towards the sun. Not incidentally, between them and the sun stand the rocky planets, such as Mars, Venus, Mercury, and Earth. In 2013, a small 20-meter rock raced through our atmosphere at 20 kilometers per second, 30 times brighter than the sun as it disintegrated. Its radiance caused retinal burns and skin burns in people watching from the ground. Before it exploded in the atmosphere over southern Russia, injuring 1,500 people, shattering thousands of windows, damaging 7,200 buildings, and crushing in garage doors from the force of the concussion for those beneath it. The path of destruction below was 180 kilometers wide, and it was equivalent to about 30 Hiroshima-sized atomic bombs, fortunately without the radiation. It exploded so high that the force was extremely attenuated by the time it reached the ground. In 1908, well over 2,000 square kilometers of trees were utterly flattened, approximately 80 million of them, when a 50 to 100 meter object burst above the Tunguska region of Siberia, between 5 and 10 kilometers up. That area is twice the size of New York City, or 20 times the size of Paris. Such an airburst today would easily wipe out virtually any city on the planet that was beneath it. Let's get out of here! Since we do not yet possess a working technology to stop a big rock from hitting Earth, though we have some really good ideas, very few of which involve blowing them up with nukes, and one which we are set to try out in 2021, it is much better if we try to spread humanity out a bit. Lunar mines and a science colony on our next-door neighbor, orbiting habitats, and even a presence on Mars are all viable options. SpaceX. Elon Musk's company is interested in putting an experimental site on Mars. They plan to start in 2022 with a pair of automated ships to head over to the Red Planet with the objective of landing successfully, probably at one of the polar regions. There will be no people on the ships. Once in place, these ships would set up a solar power array and a surface mining system. There is a lot of dry ice, which is solid CO2 in the polar regions, and a significant quantity of water ice, which is so cold that it is permanently frozen. We can see the ice caps grow and shrink seasonally on Mars as the CO2 goes from gas to solid to gas each year. The part that doesn't change is likely the water ice, which never gets warm enough to melt. The mining machines would be used to attempt to collect available water ice for separation into hydrogen and oxygen. Other tools and processes would collect atmospheric CO2 as part of that process. They can simultaneously harvest some of the sparse nitrogen gas in the atmosphere for later use by any colonist. Nitrogen is useful for growing crops, as well as forming a breathable atmosphere inside the habitats. Fuelish plans. In a rather complicated procedure, the CO2 can be processed in a specialized reactor and combined with the hydrogen extracted from the water ice. It's that reaction of CO2 plus H2O, which produces methane and oxygen. They are then liquefied for storage, which is relatively easy at the temperatures available near the Martian poles. Eventually, when needed by the next visiting crew, the methane and oxygen can be used together as fuel for the return trip. The biggest hurdle for this project is that it takes about 17 kilowatts of power per kilogram of propellant to make the fuel. And we'll need at least 20,000 kilograms, possibly more than 100,000 kilograms, depending on how heavy the return load is. Since trips are only economical about once every Martian year, close to 26 Earth months, there is lots of time to make fuel. Of course, that presupposes that there isn't a months-long dust storm that cuts off solar power for that purpose. As you can see, nothing is cut and dried or in any way certain. Mission accomplished? When the mining machines have gathered sufficient resources and the fuel depot reports that it has manufactured at least the minimum amount of fuel for a return trip, a crewed ship would be sent. They would be accompanied by additional cargo vessels. Although the ships are capable of carrying up to 100 people, it may be just 6 or 8, so more cargo can be carried on that first crewed trip. They will need air to breathe and food to eat for several months, or 2 years, depending on the plan. So capacity is essential. There is no plan to grow food on Mars, though there would certainly be a greenhouse to test the possibility and perhaps supplement the diet. They'd bring all they needed with them. Presumably, the second cargo would contain habitation modules, laboratories, and some personal space similar to how the International Space Station is constructed. At first, the crew would live in the ships until things were set up, tested, and ready to move in. Expandable modules, similar to the Bigelow Space Company's Beam module that was deployed on the ISS in 2016, could be quite useful, but nothing is set in stone. The vital components and primary purpose, however, would be the additional solar arrays, mining equipment, and fuel-making equipment. The more in-situ fuel and resources available, the more likelihood of being able to survive, allowing the possibility of an increased number of trips to Mars. Not there to build a world. The most important part of SpaceX's project is a transportation system. This early facility is nothing more than a proof of concept. It has never been SpaceX's job, as they see it, to build the colony beyond the initial test base to see if it is possible. First attempts are prone to failure, and this may be no different. There is some idea of what to expect, but we simply can't know everything. When the mission is done, all of the crew will board the ships and return to Earth. The notion of one-way trips to Mars for colonists is an artifact of narrow reporting. People could return if needed or desired, but there is a radiation hazard to long-duration space travel. You wouldn't want to do it in slow vehicles. Once they're faster, there might be monthly trips. The second wave. SpaceX will provide the method to get to Mars once they're confident they can do it. It will be up to other companies to investigate and test additional survival tricks and techniques once there. They will be the ones to create a truly independent colony that doesn't need regular shipments from Earth to function. Unlike the ISS, those tests might include habitats that are deliberately buried under surface soil to protect from radiation and the frequent storms. It only takes a fairly thin layer to reduce radiation down to safe levels for humans. Alternatively, it might also include locating a lava tube beneath the surface for natural protection. Lava tubes can be 1 kilometer tall and twice as wide, creating a vast volume of living space. Habitats built there would still have easy access to the surface, but much greater protection from radiation and meteorites. If you want multi-story buildings and Earth-like environs, you can always use artificial illumination and paint the ceiling blue. The difficulty might be making it retain an atmosphere, so the first inhabitants could start somewhat smaller. Elon Musk's boring business could conceivably prove useful there. Bored tubes could be hermetically sealed and pressurized, creating a large shirt-sleeves environment. So while SpaceX would still be involved as the trucking and delivering company, it would be up to others to do the actual dirty work of making an off-Earth home. The takeaway. We are the first intelligent life on our planet with the capability to alter our future in a significant way. Aquatic mammals never discovered fire for obvious reasons. Our simian cousins never got smart enough to develop tools beyond sticks and rocks. We took the time to look up and try to see what was going on around us. We studied and investigated until we understood that eventually, our planet will be hit by a kilometer or bigger rock and all life will be threatened again, as has happened more than once in our history. So we started to plan. We're developing technologies to stave off the inevitable, and maybe that will work. If not, getting a few thousand people off planet and making them independent will help to ensure the survival of humanity. Some fairly intelligent reptiles hung around here for about 200 million years, in total about 66 million years ago. They didn't have the technology or knowledge to survive. We do, but will we use it? If you had the opportunity, would you ever visit Mars? Let us know in the comments below, and then check out this next video that you might find interesting.